Hades, the fourth game of the studio Supergiant, exhibits a twofold commitment to its ancient Greek inspiration. Not only do we encounter many elements of Greek myth and story and gameplay, the narrative structure too follows a motif that likewise draws from Greek myth, that of patricide. During the game, the player comes to know that Zagreus has been separated from his real mother shortly after his birth. Now, grown up, he seeks to find her on the surface. His father, the god of the dead Hades, attempts to stop Zagreus from escaping the underworld and reaching the world of the living. The solution to the problem is obvious. Zagreus hacks and slashes himself a path through the underworld, and finally to the threshold between the realms of life and death itself, where he murders his dad who has come to stop him. It is not exactly hard to present this plot as being informed by the Oedipus complex. Zagreus desires his mother and seeks to destroy his father who blocks his access to her. At this point, two objections will likely be raised. One, that in Hades, the desire for the mother is anything but a sexual matter. Two, that this reading is a gross oversimplification and even misrepresentation of Hades, which does not do its complexities justice. Regarding the first accusation, it should be mentioned that when Freudian theory speaks of a libidinal attachment that is not necessarily a primarily sexual bond, but may well be a platonic, romantic or brotherly love. Freudian theory, furthermore, does not see sexual desire as radically unrelated to other forms of desire. Be that as it may, the point of Oedipus is not so much the fact of the sexual desire itself, than the disavowal of that desire and its sublimation. The second objection, however, is basically correct. Hades cannot be simply reduced down to a patricidal revenge story. This portrayal is faithful neither to the game nor to the psychoanalytical theory. In refusing the vulgar Oedipus story, Hades manages to present much more complex familial dynamics. In the following, I'd like to touch upon how Hades might serve to illuminate aspects of the family in psychoanalysis. 1. Paternal paranoia. Oedipus is first the idea of an adult paranoiac, before it is the childhood feeling of a neurotic. This is taken from Deleuze and Guattari's Anti-Oedipus. Here drawing on observations the cultural anthropologist Claude Lévi-Strauss. According to Lévi-Strauss, many of the classical patricide or Oedipal myths don't condemn the incestuous act, or, more generally, the transgression of the child. Instead, condemnation usually falls on the vengefulness of the father, which often predates the actual transgression of the child. Think, for example, of Cronus, preemptively devouring his offspring. This dynamic can be observed very well in Hades. From the very start, there is no doubt that it is Hades who is in the wrong here. Zagreus' wish for his mother is understandable and reasonable. It is Hades who forces the patricide due to his unreasonable behavior. Hades is not only a bad father who lets out his frustration over his fate relationships on his son. His behavior towards him is also marked with a certain pathetic impotence. Since he is convinced that his son, as the fates foretold, cannot become a worthy successor, he produces his failure by way of his treatment of him. His paranoia is also why the god of the dead can't confide in his son. The paternal paranoia is the driving force of the father-son conflict in Hades. Hades' relative impotence reveals itself as we come to know him more closely. He does not remain on the level of a tyrant. Rather, we learn that he is bound by rules that were imposed on him, either by himself or by the world. His inability to leave the underworld, him not having chosen it in the first place, Zagreus being able to access the bureaucracy of Hades, and so on. He is thus less an absolute sovereign and more like the top manager of the underworld, who is curtailing of his potency and the revelation of his insecurities. Hades becomes much more human and banal. The disillusion of Oedipus. This brings us to the second point. For every child, there comes the moment when they recognize that its parents do not know it all, that they can't do everything they would like to, that they have problems of their own at the workplace or in the relationships. In short, that their parents are ultimately only humans. For many, the disillusioning experience. Up until then, the parents were the nexus of responsibility, and the central problem was that of which position one should take up in relation to them. Now, the child enters complexities of societal life. In psychoanalysis, Oedipus acts simultaneously as problem and solution regarding the insertion of oneself into society. The child is charged with harboring a number of antisocial tendencies. Foremost, the total incestuous possessive demand of one parent and the resulting hatred for the other parent, who stands in the way of this demand. Despite these tendencies, Oedipus is not considered an illness or abnormality, but a necessary step in the process of socialization itself. Freudian theory speaks of a dissolution of the Oedipus complex, in which the parents are given up as sexual objects. The abandonment of this relationship, however, enables and to some extent fashions the models for later relationships with other humans and groups. The traditional functions of the father, punishment, allowing, forbidding, are displaced into the sphere of the social, and are re-encountered in particular in certain institutions such as the church. One may reject individual and paternal institutions, but the abstract and not so abstract societal rules, which comprise so many laws, the law in its abstract totality, may not be rejected. Rules in the name of the father. In the tradition of French psychoanalyst Jacques Lacan, institutions and persons which represent the paternal functions above are understood as following the logic of a signifier called the name of the father. Here is where we return to Hades. Hades is exactly such a name. It names threefold: the deity, the underworld, and the game. Just like a father may be subordinated to a function of the name of the father, for example his boss, Hades is subordinated to the laws of cosmology and his own domain, the underworld. He is unable to leave it or to alter it at will, making him its manager rather than its sovereign. In learning together with Zagreus of these limitations and renegotiating our relationship to him, in understanding that the power of the father has always already been broken, they move from the Oedipal to a post-Oedipal model of relationships and are able to tackle the real questions. How to best use the limited time on the surface? How to motivate Persephone to return? How to reintegrate Zagreus into the family? How to solve the dilemma with the Olympians? Hades as a game is of course a set of rules or laws. In debates over so-called working simulators, the following minimal definition usually gets brought up. A game is something which is circumscribed by rules and at least one failed state. The idea of prohibition and failed state is present in Lacan's term name of the father, since in French name of the father, nom du père, and no of the father, nom du père, are homophones. The failed state is this paternal no, which halts progress and forces the player to start the process anew. The third plane of the name Hades, the meta plane, is thus its role of its code as a law which is felt not only at the level of gameplay, but even at the level of story, which, characteristically for the roguelite genre, reintegrates the ludical elements of the game over screen into the narrative structure of the story. Hades' no is not exclusively destructive. The minimal definition of game also implies that it is the fail state which enables gameplay, enables us to make meaningful decisions within the game space. In Hades, the no is explicitly bound up with progression in the game, and on the level of the story too, it is never a question of eliminating the paternal no, but to shift it, to engage with it playfully. The many deaths of Zagreus and Hades are necessary for the story to take its course and for the players to progress, both as a player and in game. And even once Hades is vanquished and the Persephone returned, the paternal no does not disappear. Rather, personal anonymity is transformed into a ritual and even a job. Likewise, the no which rests on Persephone is not totally lifted, but rather renegotiated. This productive and playful engagement with the no, rather than crude opposition to it, is Hades' achievement,